So,
chugga chugga chugga.
Yep. What I'm going to do is click New, and I'm going to ask ML Studio to create a blank experiment for me. So here's the blank experiment, and I'm going to give this thing a name so that I can easily distinguish it from other experiences. What should we call this? MVA Live, something like that. Why not? Now let's call it something else. Let's call it Digit Fun, because we're going to do something with digits, as in the digits 0 through 9. Now, let me talk just a moment about what you're seeing here on the screen in front of you. This is Azure ML Studio. This is the designer that you use to build, train and score, and operationalize Azure ML models. On the left here, you see what we call the modules palette. In a moment, you're going to see me dragging modules out to the canvas out here and connecting them together to form a workflow that defines my model. I'll get those modules from the modules canvas here. There are more than 100 of them, and typically, rather than sift through all of these just to find the one that I want, I'll type something into this search box to filter those out just a bit. But let me tell you what we're going to do with this model. We're going to do OCR, and I'm not faking anything. This is going to be real OCR.
OCR, by the way, is optical character recognition.
Exactly.
It's where it's going to take a look at a picture and then detect what the text is that's on there.
Exactly right. And imagine this, Chris. You're a software developer like I am.
Mm-hmm.
Writing code to do OCR algorithmically would be a very difficult thing to do.
I've got better things to do with my time.
Absolutely right.
Yeah, Gotham is coming back on the air, you know?
Exactly right. So, and especially if it has to work not just with, like, printed characters, but handwritten characters.
Right.
So we're going to do OCR. We're going to build an ML model that does OCR. Then we're going to build an app that talks to that model to prove that when you and I draw characters on the screen,
mm-hmm.
it can tell what we drew. How about that?
Okay,
pretty cool.
Yeah.
Now, the first thing we need is data, right?
Yes.
It always starts with the data. Where do we get the data from? So it turns out there are a number of public data repositories that folks who are working with ML or learning ML can go to get interesting data sets. One of those is a repository maintained by UCI, the University of California, Irvine. I went to their repository, downloaded a public data set in which they asked 40-something people to handwrite the digits 0 through 9 several times. Then UCI digitized that data and published as a CSV file the digitized data. So we're going to use that data in our model. We'll be using real OCR data. It's not just something we've tricked up. It's real mm-hmm. OCR data. Now, how do we do that? Well, there's several sample data sets in ML Studio that you can use, but we don't want to use a sample data set. We want to use this UCI data. So I'm going to go down here and click plus new, and I'm going to choose data set, and I'm going to ask to upload a data set from a local file. Now, I have already downloaded this data set. By the way, it was a pretty clean data set to begin with. I did some minor cleaning on it mm-hmm. by hand outside of Azure ML, but it was a pretty darn good data set to begin with. So let's go find that data set. It's a CSV file, one of many, many, many formats that is supported here in Azure ML. And let's see here. If I go out to desktop and live event, here it is. It's called digit-recognition.csv. And we'll take a look inside this data set here in a moment also so that you can see what it looks like. But it is a CSV file. It's one of the common ways that data is packaged for machine learning. And we can give it a name if we want. We can also provide an optional description. But we'll just accept the defaults there. And now if I go into the modules palette on the left and look under my data sets, we should see one that says UCI digit recognition. I'm going to drag that module out to the canvas. So that's the first step in building our Azure ML model. Now, notice this little circle here underneath the module. That's called a port. All modules have at least one port. Many of them have multiple ports, input ports and output ports. Cool thing about an output port is I can click it, select visualize from the menu, and I can see what is actually coming through in that part of the model. So what I'm going to do here is get a quick look at the data set that I just imported. Now, with limited screen real estate, we'll have to do some scrolling around, but let's clear that out. So the structure of this data is thusly. There are 3,823 rows of data, each one representing the digitized version of a handwritten digit by one of the test subjects at UCI. Each row contains 65 values. The first 64 values are labeled P01, P02, etc. What the researchers who built this data set did was very simple. They digitized the handwritten digits, and they did it using a grid that measures 32 by 32 pixels, if you will. Actually, 8 by 8 pixels. The 64 values in columns P01 through P64 are values from 0 to 16, essentially indicating how many dots in a 4 by 4 grid in that cell have ink in them, if you will. So it's a fairly opaque way of digitizing the data. Essentially, for each digit, we have 64 values, each a value from 0 to 16. But that is the data that we're putting into our model and the data that we're going to use when we build an app to use it. Now, if I scroll all the way over to the right, you'll see the column that we're going to do predictions on. That column is called digit, and this column shows what digit, 0 through 9, corresponds to all these values over on the left. This one corresponds to a 0, for example. This, all the data in this row corresponds to a 6. So I can scroll down through there. It's not showing me all 3,800 columns, but it's, you know, for a lot of data scientists, it's a fairly small data set, but it's large enough that we're going to be able to do real things with it here. So that's step one, bringing in the data. Now, here's step two. We're going to use a classification algorithm because ultimately, we want our model to look at a set of 64 values representing a bunch of dots and to tell us which of the digits 0 through 9 that dot pattern represents. One of the things that I need to do, and this is very important, is tell the model that that value that we're going to ask it to predict is a categorical value, not a continuous value, not a number like an age or gas mileage. It is a digit 0 through 9. So an easy way to do that.
So that really, the fact that it's a number is sort of secondary, that what you're really looking for to do is detect a character. So we're not looking for an actual rating here, that the fact that it's a 0 versus a 9 is irrelevant, that it really is that we're just looking for the character itself.
That's right.
Okay.
That's right.
Yep.
We're going to feed the 64 values representing a bunch of basically random dots.
Right.
And the model's going to tell us is that a 0, 1, 2, 3, et cetera.
Right. I gotcha.
Here's the interesting thing. It's machine learning. It makes the computer sound really smart. The computer has no idea what it's trying to predict.
Right.
It's just looking at that data and doing what we tell it to do.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay? So we're going to go back to ML Studio, and I'm going to add an edit metadata module to the palette or to the canvas here. See that I typed edit into the search box. Here's the edit metadata module. Now, the edit metadata module is pretty cool. It lets you do things like put custom labels on columns and several other things. But the reason it's really important right here is that we need to tell the model that since we're going to ask it to predict a value from that digit column, that is a categorical value, not a numeric value. So with the edit metadata module selected, I'll click Launch Column Selector on the right. And I will choose, I will select the digit column. And it looks like that's going to work. Let's see, let's just make sure here, Christopher. So I told it to begin with no columns, but I want to include the columns that are named right here. Digit is the name of that column that we're going to use in our predictive analytics. So that should be fine. Now, the really important part is that I need to change the categorical property of it from the default to make categorical. Now, see this little red circle right here?
That's usually an indication something's not right.
That's right. That's Azure ML Studio telling me something's not right. That's because I haven't connected the output from the data set to the input to the port, and that's why I had to type in digit. Since I hadn't done that, edit metadata didn't know about the columns coming into it. If we go back there now, if I remove digit, now I see a drop-down list that I can select from. So always pay attention to the little red circles with the exclamation marks. Again, what's really important about what we're doing here is we are telling the model that the values in that digit column are not numeric values, but instead are categorical values. In fact, if I don't do that, this model will not work. So far, so good. We have data. We have told the model that one of the columns in that data should be treated as categorical data rather than numerical data. So here's the next thing that I'm going to do. I'm going to go back over to the modules palette and find a split data module. And here's the reason I'm doing this, Christopher. When we build and train and score ML models, we use data to do the training, but then to assess how accurately the models can do predictive analytics, we need data to score the model against as well. So what data scientists like to do is have two data sets, one for training, one for scoring. But oftentimes in the real world, you don't have two data sets, you just have one. The split data module allows you to take one data set and split it into two. So, kind of having my cake and eating it too here. So what I'm going to do is connect the output from edit metadata to the input to split data, and I'm going to move these things around just a little bit just to get myself some room here. And when the split data module is selected, over here I can specify how it's split. Now, by default, 50% of the data is going to come out of the left output port, 50% is going to come out of the right output port. I'm going to change this fractional value to 0.8. This means that 80% of the data is going to be coming out of here, 20% from here. I'm going to use 80% of the data for training the model and 20% for scoring. It's always best to have more data when you train that model. Now, how are we actually going to train it? Well, that's pretty easy as well. Because over in the modules palette, I can find a train model module and just drag it out to the canvas like I would all of these other modules. And more importantly, I'm going to take the output from split data, this is the 80% split, and connect it to the right input port of train model. So when we run this model now, the model will be trained, and it will be trained using 80% of the data in the data set I brought in. But you'll notice once more, there's this indication telling me that something needs to be done. So this is the point at which we need to specify a learning algorithm. And this is where I might go back to that Azure ML cheat sheet that I showed you in the slides to figure out what type of algorithm to use. Now, the algorithms in the box, there are 25 of them. And remember, you can code your own in R and Python if you want to. But the ones built into the box are available as modules in the modules palette. So I'm going to go find one named Multi-Class Logistic Regression.
That was the one I was thinking of.
You know, I woke up last night thinking about multi-class logistic regression, and I think about it all the time. Now, let me tell you a little bit about this. Again, this is one of the 25 or so models built or algorithms built into the box. Multi-class logistic regression is a very commonly used algorithm in data science. It uses regression internally, but it's actually a classification algorithm. Multi-class means I want the model to predict for me a value from a finite set of output values, as in the digits 0 through 9, but not just two of them. In this case, 10 different possible values. Now, the way multi-class logistic regression works internally, it's actually using regression to predict the probability that the input data you give it represents each of the possible outputs. And then the one that it tells you is the correct output is the one that it computed the highest probability for. So out in the data science community, this stuff is old news. This is also called logic regression. It's been around for a long time. But again, this is a very, very important part of this process because now I will connect that algorithm to the left input port of train model. So I now have specified an algorithm and I'm feeding data into train model right here. Now you'll notice once more, ML Studio is telling me, wait a minute, Jeff, there's something that you haven't done. What is it? Well, let's select the train model module. This is an equally important part. It has to know what value do you want me to predict when you train me. So once more, I'm going to enter that digit column. The model now knows that when I train it and I ask it to do predictive analytics by feeding values into it, I want it to give me a value from the digit column. There are only 10 of those, the digits 0 through 9. And remember, I made those categorical values, so this will hopefully work pretty well. Now, one of the things I like to do when I'm working with ML Studio is save the model from time to time. That way, if something goes wrong or what have you, you can get back to where you were quickly. Not a bad idea either to run the model. Now, when I run the model, it's actually executing. We're not going to see anything come out of it yet. We will in a moment. But out there in the cloud, it's actually devoting compute resources to it now and training the model. And you can see as each step in the model is completed, a green check mark appears in the corresponding module. So we're executing train model right now. The model is learning from the data that we sent in there. And now that I have a green check mark, we just trained a model.
Cool. Now, so two real quick things. Number one is I'm going to guess that if we had a larger data set, that that training would have taken a lot longer, especially if you were trying to maybe predict something that was a bit more complex.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
The second
thing
is...
Let me say something
about
that.
Yeah, please.
You're exactly right. If I had fed in a data set with millions of rows, it's going to take longer to do that. Now, remember, one of the cool things about Azure ML is it will auto-scale that for you. But here's the really important thing. The execution time of an ML model, once the model is trained, is basically independent of the training time. So I do the work up front. Maybe it takes 30 minutes to do the training and lots of compute resources. Once it's trained, running it, having to do predictive analytics is little more than executing an equation.
Oh, okay.
So it's a one-time cost, if you will.
Okay.
Yeah.
Perfect. I like it.